as a king, feeling good and everything, just like a bird in the spring. Gotta let it out, it's my sweetie, can't you guess? Wild about him, I'll confess. Does he love me? That's why I shout. Everybody loves my baby, but my baby don't love nobody but me. Nobody but me. Now everybody wants my baby, but my baby don't want nobody but me. That's plain to see. That's why everybody loves my baby, but my baby don't love nobody but me. Nobody but me.
And now, Loughborough University drama finalists present A Tale of Murder and Suspense in part one of Mystery at Morton Hall, inspired by J.J. Farjeon's 13 Guests.
Most people would look back at 36 as one of those dreadful years where nothing particularly eventful happened. I suppose you could have excited yourself with that royal chaos Miss Simpson caused, if you're into that kind of thing. I did not. I was too busy with one of my earliest and most intricate murders. The events that unfolded at Morton Hall over the course of a single weekend nearly two decades ago were never those of a cut-and-dried case. Never neatly packaged with concrete evidence and satisfactory convictions. It's a case which troubled me for years after the file was closed, and one I shall never forget. The story started at a rural railway station in the southern countryside, Woodcroft Station for those of you familiar with the area. In this job you get to know stations, see enough of them. Stolen suitcases, fugitives making a getaway, bodies on tracks. You get to learn the smells and sounds and that special voice that each station seems to have. Some are of grit, some are of sand, some are of milk churns or of iron and steel. Woodcroft Station was gravelly, rough, busy.
The train now approaching platform one is the 3:28 from Paddington. This is Woodcroft, Woodcroft Station.
Can I help you down, madam? Or do you need a hand with that suitcase?
Thank you so very much, sir. And I wonder if you can tell me, there is supposed to be a car waiting to take me to Morton Hall? My name is...
Eleanor Carson, 30 years old, recently widowed. She was slim, all porcelain complexion with full lips and hair tinged with bronze. Needless to say, she drew plenty of attention. Worth noting that she marked the first of Addington's guests.
Ah, yes, miss. Was it the car for, Morton Hall? Yes, I mean, of course, it would be Morton Hall. Let me just... Arthur! Over here, Arthur! Excuse me, madam, if you could just give me one moment. I just need to...
All aboard! All aboard! The train standing at platform one will be departing in 30 seconds. Final call, departing Woodcroft Station in 30 seconds.
Hello, sir. We've got tea, coffee, and a selection of biscuits.
What? What's that? Where? Oh, excuse me, miss. Did he just say Woodcroft? Damn it! Oh, excuse me. No, please. Sir, excuse me. Thank you. Oh, excuse me. Could you let me pass? Thank you. Yes, that's mine, if you wouldn't mind. I need to get off this train. Don't go yet. Let me off first. Wait a minute. Hold the train. You there? Station master. Over here. My bag. Catch. Now,
sir,
stand
I
back.
That's a good idea.
I'm going
stay
to...
Stay inside the carriage, sir. Passengers are not permitted to... Jump.
Ouch.
Sir, are you all right, sir?
All right. Of course I'm not all right. Why the bloody hell don't you show the name of your station in larger letters? Oh, I didn't realise there was a lady present. I do apologise.
Quite unnecessary. Swear as much as is good for you, which is probably rather a lot. You did take quite a nasty fall. Is your leg... Are you all right?
Thank you, but please don't worry about me. I'm fine now. Absolutely fine.
Oh dear.
He fainted then, that good-looking man who had just tumbled from the train, out cold. His name was John Foss, 37 at the time. Though he lacked an invitation to Morton Hall, he more than made up for it in the widow's eyes with his charming good nature.
Well, we can't very well leave him on the floor. Station master, is there any word from the chauffeur?
Should be arriving shortly. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, he's here. Want me to carry your bags?
I can muck in if you can carry our man to the rolls.
Certainly. Though his ankle looks rather bad, he'll need to see a doctor about that. Sharpish.
Yes, definitely. Do you think you can get him into the car, driver?
Easy, madam. If you're after a doctor, you'll need a Dr. Pedro.
And where might we find him?
He's up at Morton Hall, attending to old Mrs. Harris.
Well, isn't that fortunate, then? Morton Hall is where we're headed ourselves. Step two, driver.
Is this... Oh, where am I?
More importantly, where are you going? Morton Hall, where with any luck, we'll get the good doctor to have a look at you. No, don't argue. Rest now. I'm afraid you're coming with me.
If you insist.
The gravelly voice of Woodcroft Station melted into the distance as Eleanor Carson and John Foss's journey was set into motion. However, they were not the only ones bound for Morton Hall. No less than 11 other guests were also set in the same direction. Mr. Foss's graceful arrival at Woodcroft on the 3:28 was preceded by that of the 12:10 a little earlier in the day. Aboard this express were four other guests. There was sausage-making royalty Mr. and Mrs. Rawlings with their sausage heiress of a daughter, Rose. And then Mr. Lawrence Huckabee, first-class cricketer and first-class chap. Little did any of them know what their jolly hunting weekend had in store. Deer weren't the only thing fated to meet an untimely end. There was another man aboard the 12:10, as with every compelling murder case, Morton Hall too had its shadow. Mr. Jack Pearson, aged 48, was a mysterious, nervous-looking man. The sort to jump at the buzzing of a fly, but hiss right back at any snake. He departed the train quickly and quietly and went straight into the somewhat fusty coolness of the Black Stag Inn, where his window seat overlooked Woodcroft's platform.
Pot of tea, sir. And if you want in a room for the night, let me take that for you.
Don't touch my bag. I mean, yes, I'll have a pot of tea. I might want a room for the night. I'm not sure. I'll let you know.
Station's busy today. Addingtons must be having some sort of party. All these interesting faces. It's not something we often see in old Woodcroft, eh?
There is another train at 5:56, yes?
You know, that's the third time you've asked me that. That's it now.
I need to go.
Another train, another addition to the case. The Chaters, Mr. and Mrs. A lovely couple, if moral ambiguity and cryptic behaviour is your type. Mr. Chater, highly unlikable with a constant air of aggression, and his wife, a cold woman with a smile that did not quite reach her eyes.
Mr. and Mrs. Chater?
That's Chater.
Ah, yes, of course. My mistake, sir. I'll take your bags to the car. And of course, it's Zena Wilding.
Yes, Zena Wilding. Surely then you must have seen me in the country house murder quite recently? Oh dear, am I keeping everybody waiting?
Yes.
Ah, the infamous Eugene Spencer, a self-made columnist 37, wrote plenty, said little, always seemed to be in the right place at the right time, somehow always 10 steps ahead of the game.
Spencer, why do you always insist on taking notes? We haven't even arrived at the damn house yet.
I like to keep track. Miss Wilding, may I ask, do you know that man standing over there by the ticket office?
What man?
Over there, in the shadows. He seems to be staring at you.
This way, madam.
Is something the matter?
Nothing. Nothing at all.
Odd.
Care for a light?
I'll see you later.
I wouldn't.
Even odder. You are supposed to burn one end of those things, you know. Well, my name is Eugene Spencer, and
you're the bleeding gossip columnist.
The society diarist, I'll thank you not to lower me. I happen to be spending the weekend at Morton Hall. I shall be there until Monday morning. I pay for material, provided, of course, that my newspaper column can use it.
Morton Hall, eh? Oh yes, you'll get something to write about.
Morton Hall had an air of grandeur which elevated it above the average country home. 3 floors provided ample space to host the invited visitors during their weekend of excess and hunting, and a decadent drawing room and dedicated kitchen ensured that entertaining the eclectic group of guests was almost too easy. Lord Addington, 67, was never quiet about these frequent gatherings held for his interesting friends. On the contrary, his enthusiasm and brash hospitality made these weekends quite the unmissable social event for anybody who was a somebody. Ever the perfect host, Addington was there to greet them all as they arrived at his humble home.
Thomas, stop scowling. Get over there and see to the ruling suitcases. Don't let me find they've been taken to the wrong rooms.
Certainly, my lord.
Bessie, that's nearly all of them. You'd better get down to the cellar and tell Cook to dig out some extra crates of that 29 Clicquot for later. I think we're going to need them.
Yes, my lord.
Evening, Lord Addington. Has John been moved to the anteroom?
Why, yes, Eleanor. I thought it made sense, what with the state of his ruddy ankle. Why'd you ask?
No reason, really. Although, seeing as I brought the poor chap here, I feel duty-bound to entertain him.
Yes. Well, I hope he finds the room comfortable. It has a splendid view of the grounds and the studio. Beaumont's working in there already, I believe. Foss can be his audience.
And how Mr. Beaumont will rejoice at that.
Thomas, have you seen Sir Andrew? Thought he'd be here to welcome those guests of his, the Chaters.
I believe he's still in his room, sir. Hmm.
Very well. Well, that will be them now. Welcome! Spencer, Miss Wilding, and you must be Mr. Chater, Mrs. Chater.
Yes, Lord Addington, a pleasure to meet you.
Yes, quite, I must say. I was expecting Sir Andrew to be here to greet you. However, he seems to have retired to his room. Everett, old man, there you are. Dorothy, how wonderful of you to join us.
Sir Andrew Everett, 53, a Member of Parliament for the Liberal Party. Yes, the Liberals did have one or two members in 36, although it was anyone's guess as to how long they'd retain any serious political say.
Jumping ship to the Conservatives was a tactical move in the making for Sir Andrew, an attempt to stay afloat which brought him to Morton and to the table of one Tory Addington.
Ah, Chater. Pleasant journey?
Yes, thank you. Will we be talking later, Andrew?
But Sir Andrew, and yes, I'm sure we will.
In that case then, I would like to be shown to our room for now. I am tired.
Well, that was strange. That Mr. Chater reminds me of a character from My Murder on the River Severn. A highly unlikable fellow. It was quite the bestseller, you know.
I must have missed that one.
I'll have my editor send me a copy to sign for you. It really is one of my best...
I have no doubt it is, Dorothy.
Addington! I'm only going to need a few more sessions with your Miss Emilia in the studio. A few finishing touches, nothing more. Ah, the last of the party has arrived.
Celebrated portraiture artist Louis Beaumont, there at Morton Hall to paint Lord Addington's daughter, the Honourable Lady Amelia. Flamboyant in nature, his unique style had him highly sought after. His obvious skill was his ability to capture the striking ladies of high society. These portrayals of pretty young things were enough to drive a man wild. Admittedly, money could sway Beaumont to paint a plain girl, but he'd quite happily paint a poor one for nothing but the pleasure and artistry, if she was beautiful. Often Beaumont and his paintbrush had the uncanny ability to expose perhaps a little more than his subjects would care to reveal at face value.
Ah, Bessie, there you are. Did you find Cook? Excellent!
I haven't seen you before. Awfully pretty for a maid, no?
Thank you, sir.
Show Mr. Spencer to his room, please, Bessie.
Of course, my lord. This way, if you please.
No matter, no matter. I can take you, Eugene. You're sharing with me.
Of course. Then, Bessie, please show Miss Booth and Sir Andrew to their rooms. I trust the Rawlings have found their ways without any issues. Thomas?
Yes, sir.
Zina, can I speak with you?
Of course. What can I help you with?
One of the somebodies to receive the Lord's invitation was the sparkling thespian, Miss Zina Wilding. Addington was characteristically vocal about this benevolent relationship between talented actress and potential financial backer, but the keener eyes at the party rarely missed the somewhat lengthy glances between the pair. Nor did they miss the look on the admirable Lady Addington's slender face whenever Wilding floated into the room.
I was thinking about the proposition you raised in your recent letters.
Yes?
It's becoming more and more probable. Every day.
Well, that's wonderful news.
Yes, yes, it just might well be. I'll see you at dinner. And I have something I want to show you later.
Oh, I'm sure that will be wonderful. Would you be so kind as to show me to my room?
Ah, yes, yes, of course.
Oh, much cooler in here. What a relief.
I really thought I had you at that last fence, Amelia. I get mightily sick of looking at the back of your head.
Now, Lawrence, you should know by now that what you lack in horsemanship, you make up for in wickets.
Oh, Amelia, you wound me. I would have liked to have seen you in that scorching match against Cambridge last Saturday. Do you have a batting average of 41.66? I think not.
Yes, Huckabee, all very impressive. I'm sure Sussex would quite frankly flounder without you.
These new occupants of Morton's hallway brought with them the dust and heat of an afternoon's hack. Amelia Addington, then 25, had a slim, boyish figure with a hard mouth that somehow didn't distract from her beauty. There isn't much to note about Amelia, other than her particular fondness for her grandmother, the poor Mrs. Harris. Amelia was the only person in her household to spend any considerable amount of time with the old lady in the attic room of the house. Finding Amelia together with Mr. Lawrence Huckabee was also something of a common occurrence on these weekends. She enjoyed his easy company, and he appreciated her warm and undemanding nature.
It's already 6:30.
Does that mean tea in your room?
No, I'll be down, but the bath comes first. These clothes are sticking to me.
I will see you in half an hour then.
Yes, and at Father's party tonight.
Save a foxtrot for me.
Of course, Lawrence. I hope you dance better than you ride.
As always, Amelia paused for a while at her grandmother's lonely attic room. She knew that if she didn't, another day would pass for the beloved woman without the company of a single soul. I was young and naive when I was set to work at Morton. It was one of the first big jobs I served on, and I vividly remember how much the case intimidated me. All those people tangled up inside a huge melting pot of secrets, motive, and narcissism. Two particularly potent sources of this narcissism found themselves sharing quarters that weekend. Perhaps too much narcissism for one room, but share they must for the sake of accommodating Addington's plentiful guests. Friends? Rivals? I was never quite sure, yet both took comfort in the knowledge that their intellects set them apart from the mere mortals they were to be trapped with. The DI said they reminded him of two distinctive old lions, negotiating lazily over their prey.
I assume this was your idea, Beaumont?
Our little weekend as roommates? Of course it was, Eugene. I suggested it to Addington myself.
Indeed. Well, to start with, you can remove this quite frankly sickening collection of... Sorry, you call these shirts. The top drawer is mine.
Ah, you Englishmen. No style. So boring.
Quite.
Well, I was certain you wouldn't mind. Especially since my little bird has been whispering all sorts of juicy morsels into my ear whilst I have been here. Morsels that would undoubtedly make a fascinating paragraph or two in next week's Express, if they fell into the hands of a columnist of the highest prestige and skill. A paragraph or two, maybe even a whole column. Two whole columns? Eugene, I do like the desperate way you beg me for information.
I don't beg. Well?
Ah, okay. Fascinating morsel number one. Miss Zina Wilding, age 32 by the kindness of her friends, 42 by the unkindness of her enemies, and 38 by the justice of God.
She's actually 37. If you're going to try to feed me stories, please at least get your facts right.
She has long awaited the sizable theatrical opportunity she so thoroughly does not deserve. She may receive the promise of the necessary backing by Monday. Do you have to smoke that in here, you animal?
The potential backer is our esteemed host, Addington. They first met on the Riviera in spring. He was clearly very taken with her, and has now invited her to Morton Hall this weekend, where she is planning to charm his lordship.
Charm. What a tactful word.
Into stumping up a sizable packet of cash in order to finance her comeback performance. Move on.
Very well. Fascinating morsel number two. The celebrated artist Louis Beaumont, who has the world of portraiture at his feet, has been a resident at Morton Hall for several days and is now completing a portrait of the Honorable Emilia Addington, designed for next year's Royal Academy. Eugene, old friend, you truly are a very hard man to please. Alright, fascinating morsel number three. It is rumored that if Sir Andrew Everett is to survive politically, he will need to abandon the Liberal Party and turn his allegiance elsewhere.
Common knowledge.
Wait for it. My little bird informs me that conversation has already taken place between Sir Andrew and Addington to the effect that if Sir Andrew does not decide to throw in his lot with the Tories, he would be given the hand of the Honorable Emilia Addington.
Really? And what does the Honorable Emilia think of that? I see. Not impressed. Well, anything else I should know?
Only that our Lord Addington expects to be in very great favours if he lands Sir Andrew, and perhaps receive a fat little marquis title for his party leaders in return.
How nice.
Well, such a standing would mean all sorts of extra costs for him. He's already secretly harassed for funds. How on earth do you think he will meet these enhanced expenses?
Oh, I'm sure you're about to tell me.
Well, my little bird does suggest that perhaps our resident sausage king and queen, the Rollings, may be of some financial aid. You know, King Rolling made his fortune from selling sausages, yes? Boring couple. You've been lucky to avoid them. Well, supposedly if Addington helps to launch their little piglet rose into society with a capital S, it is possible that Mommy and Daddy would be so grateful the Lord would be able to support a marquisate title after all. I charge 3 and 10 pence for that one.
Hardly worth 2 bob, I'd say. A pity you couldn't tell me anything about the most interesting people here.
Who? Oh.
Mr. and Mrs. Chater.
The Chaters, yes. I admit, there I am beaten. My little bird knows nothing about the Chaters.
Grandma, it's me, Amelia. Can I come in?
Yes, dear. Come through.
Old Mrs. Harris, what a sorry creature she was. Despite being her grandmother's only visitor, Amelia never deviated from those 3 even knocks on the attic door. No one ever paid attention to the old lady. In truth, she merely existed whilst counting down her days of suffering and ill health. Still, Amelia was her pride and joy, and made those long hours that little bit more bearable.
Could you help me find the piece with the straight edge? I think it's going to have a section of the sky on it too.
So I'm looking for the blue one, Granny?
Yes, Amelia, dear. A blue one.
You know, it's Father's party tonight. I believe most of the guests have arrived by now. We always count down the days until this place returns to normal.
Have you picked out something pretty to wear?
I wish you could come downstairs. You know, it would mean the world to me.
And I'll be right here for you to tell me all about it. Have you managed to find that piece yet?
Try this one. If it doesn't fit, I'll keep...
Oh, well, would you look at this? My puzzle. It's nearly complete.
Thanks to the graceful manner in which John Foss departed the train at Woodcroft, it wasn't only old Grandma Harris that was bedbound during the events which unfolded over that weekend at Morton Hall. John Foss's presence in Lord Addington's anteroom remained consistent, where he was effectively trapped, lying rather awkwardly on a chaise lounge, if I remember rightly. He was a curious man, John Foss. I could never quite tell if he wanted to be there or not.
So you're our uninvited guest. How is that leg of yours doing, old chap? I trust Dr. Pedreau will have you on the mend in no time. Fixed me up sharpish after I bungled a leg slide last summer.
Guilty as charged, and I do hope so. I wouldn't want to impose.
Impose? Addington welcomes all sorts here, so don't you go worrying yourself about imposing. Quite revels in the charitability of it all, I imagine. Good for the image, you know?
Well, even so, everyone has been very accommodating.
As they always are. The name is Lawrence, by the way. Lawrence Huckabee. I play for Sussex. And bat better than I do much else. Lord Addington loves a circus, and, well, I'm happy to be a part of it.
Well, pleasure to meet you, Huckabee. There are rather a lot of you here. Are you familiar with the woman who brought me here?
Yes, Miss Eleanor Carson, our attractive widow. Susceptible people need to keep out of her way. She leaves quite the trail of broken hearts.
That almost sounds like advice.
Well, if it is good advice.
Well, I should like to thank her.
Is that all?
There you are, Lawrence. I was beginning to think you had disappeared. Ah, you must be the man from the station. Mr. Foss, wasn't it?
Please call me John.
John, this is Miss Amelia Addington. Another devil you must watch.
Oh, do be quiet, Lawrence. He doesn't find you amusing. I heard you had quite the fall, John.
Yes, I've been told it looks spectacular.
Well, I hope Father is looking after you. Do let us know if there's anything else you need.
Thank you. I'm quite content.
Right. Well, by now I'm sure the man is tired of everyone cooing around him. We will leave you to rest.
Not at all.
Anything at all, you let us know.
Thank you.
Ah, so you're the gentleman who nearly broke his neck trying to get onto Woodcroft's platform. Not worth dying for, if you ask me. By the look of that leg, I think you'll be here for quite some time. Do forgive me, I don't think we've been acquainted. Andrew Everett, and what might we call you?
John Foss.
Well, John Foss, I would have said you are quite lucky.
I'm not sure I would agree with you there, but I will take your word for it.
Ah, even so, the facts remain. Shame you'll miss out on the plans for this weekend, though.
I'm afraid I'm ignorant to what you mean, sir. The only thing I know about Morton is the interior of its anteroom.
Ah, well, of course. Allow me to enlighten you. These grounds are excellent for hunting, particularly deer. They imbalance the natural order of things, what with their constant feeding, so it falls on us to level the playing field. Keep everything fair, you know. Addington loves to make a show of it, but it's not for the faint of heart.
Maybe I'm safest in here, then.
Well, it's nearly time for dinner. Will you be joining us?
Doubtful. I don't fancy being carried to the table.
Ah, well, there is no doubt we'll meet again. In the meantime, keep your wits about you, eh?
Hello? I do hope you don't mind me barging in like this. Amelia said you were looking rather lonely, and I thought I'd come to investigate the fuss. John, isn't it? I'm Rose Rawling.
Pleasure to meet your acquaintance. Not as excited as you'd hoped, I'm sure.
Oh, on the contrary. When you leave the house as little as I do, it's not difficult to get excited about all manner of things. How did that happen?
My leg? Well, to tell you the truth, it was my own carelessness, pure and simple. Next time I take the train, I will try not to sleep through my stop.
Easily done. You're not in any pain, are you?
Barely. Are you at Morton for the hunt?
Oh, no. I squirm at the thought. Poor things. My parents are big in the meat industry and recently became friendly with Lord Addington. It seems that once your family makes its money, everyone wants to know you. Funny that.
I see. Well, it's a good job that you aren't naive, but I'm sure that is not the only reason.
Oh, I didn't mean to interrupt. I'll come back
later. No! Well, I mean, don't worry, it's fine.
I was just leaving. I hope your leg heals quickly, Mr. Foss.
Thank you, Rose.
I didn't realise you had company already. Are you sure you don't mean to come back later?
No, please stay, I insist. Odd sort of girl, that one.
Yes, I'm not sure she's enjoying the society life much.
So it would seem. I've been wanting to thank you.
No need. It's the Addingtons you should be thanking.
Yes, I've just met their daughter. However, I would no doubt be in a much worse state of affairs if you had not taken pity on me.
Well then, for what it's worth, you're welcome. Couldn't leave you there to rot now, could we?
Well, I wouldn't have blamed you. I'm terribly glad it was you that found me and not one of the others. Oh, I mean, at least you haven't asked me how I am. I couldn't bear to answer again.
Well, I'm sure you're feeling quite horrendous. I do have eyes.
Tell you the truth, you're right. And I'm so very relieved to hear it. Well, I hear you've all gathered here for a hunt this weekend. Will the poor creature have you on its tail?
I'll certainly be trying my best, but the damn things never do make it easy. Aren't those curtains ghastly?
Sorry? Curtains? Well, I mean, I suppose they are. They're not my taste, per se. It's certainly not the worst room I've ever slept in.
Well, I've never noticed them until now. How horrid. So is that what brought a man like you to Woodcroft Station? Escaping terrible bedroom decor?
To the point, then, I see.
I find small talk rarely ever accomplishes anything.
I think you're right. As for why I'm here, I suppose I was after a change of scenery. I certainly got what I wished for.
Well, there's certainly scenery here. I hope you enjoy the view. The garden is rather glorious in the sunshine. You can see right to the top of the hills on a cloudless day.
It's the second time now you've engaged in small talk.
Is it? Well, I suppose it's safer. Everyone makes exceptions now and again, John.
Well, you don't strike me as everyone.
It's getting late. I'll leave you to rest for now.
Thank you. Eleanor, don't be a stranger.
The studio where Louis Beaumont was working during his stay at Morton sat not too far from the house, nestled within the tree line at the bottom of the sweeping lawn. In the evenings, the chandelier light from the arched windows of Foss's anteroom fell in pale stretches across the grass, but didn't quite spread far enough to reach the shadow of the studio. As Beaumont recalled to us, it was around 7 o'clock that he finished his meal, before heading out onto the veranda, which overlooked the building where his portrait of Amelia resided. He found that he was not alone in his search for air, as he came across Eleanor Carson, who was there already, looking out into the darkness beyond.
I don't suppose you happen to have a cigarette. Huckabee offered me one of his, but he smokes those silly black Russian ones. Thank you.
Don't move for a moment. The lady with the cigarette, the lady in green, modern Eve, woman, anything you like, when do I paint her?
Oh, Mr. Beaumont, she would have to pawn her pearls to pay your price, and I think she'd rather not. Thank you. Anyone who paints me must be an out-and-out romantic. With a very kind heart.
I would never have thought you feared the truth, Mrs. Carson.
I don't fear it. But no artist can paint the whole truth. He just paints his half. Maybe a little too well. And the other half cannot answer back from the canvas. It is your half I fear, Mr. Beaumont.
Then may I be as bold as to ask, what is this whole truth you so bravely bear, Eleanor?
And why do you think I'd arm you with that sort of information?
Because there's freedom in truth. Those who are more concerned with how they appear than with who they are tend to whine and complain that my work reveals more than they necessarily wanted to show. But I think you value the honesty in that, no?
When you lose a husband, you think the world will simply end. Aren't we expected to all but die with them as wives? But I never felt that way. It never affected me in the way perhaps it should have. I feel like I've simply been waiting for, well, something. Maybe I'll find it this weekend, Mr. Beaumont.
As Eleanor walked away, Beaumont's attention settled on his current project. He enjoyed painting the beautiful Amelia, but wondered now how she felt about his half. Did she too fear that he may reveal the depths of her personality a little too well? He told us this was his reason for venturing to the studio at such an odd evening hour. He decided, as apparently artists do, that he might apply some finishing touches that night, before joining Addington's soiree with Eleanor's words in mind. The following is taken directly from our first interview with Beaumont. I still have a copy of the notes even now. I delved into my pocket as I walked to find the key to the studio, only my pocket was empty. As I reached the door, I found my key there
in the lock, and the door, well, it was slightly ajar. So naturally I lit a match from my cigarette case, and I ventured into the darkness beyond. My painting! Ruined! A dirty snare of crimson from edge to edge. But who? No one is in here. They must have already fled. Who is there? You there, stop!
It was too dark. I was unable to make out who this man was. What Beaumont also failed to notice that night, though he did not know it at the time, was the shadowy gap in between the ruined portrait of Amelia and the left-hand wall of the studio. A blind spot just large enough to conceal the unknown vandal, perhaps. The artist fumed as he walked back to the veranda, and there he now found Mr. Chater, stood ominously in the same spot that Beaumont himself had occupied just 5 minutes earlier.
Good evening.
Is it?
Well, I think so. Rather a nice place, isn't it? Just having a stroll around, getting my bearings. The name's Chater, by the way.
Yes, I've heard your name. I'm afraid you won't see much in this darkness.
Where is that? That building you've come in from? Is it the stables?
No, it is the studio.
Oh, yes. There's an artiste here, isn't there?
Yes, there is. A Louis Beaumont.
And is he painting anybody here?
Yes.
Who would that be, may I ask?
It looks like you will anyway. Lord Addington's daughter.
Ah, yes, Miss Amelia. Rather attractive girl. Didn't I hear something about her and Everett? Some kind of involvement or something?
I believe there is a talk of possible engagement.
Is there? Oh. I'd rather like to see that portrait. Is one allowed in the studio?
I'm afraid it's locked.
Locked? Then how did you...
I have the only key. I locked the studio.
Ah. Then it sounds as if you're Louis Beaumont.
I am.
Yeah. Suppose I can see it.
I locked the studio a few minutes ago after finding it unlocked.
Unlocked? How strange.
Indeed.
A few minutes ago, I was saying good evening to a maid. I'd just come outside when I met you.
I see. Did you meet anybody else?
Excuse me? Mr. Beaumont, what is this all about?
Nothing to worry you.
Very well. Perhaps we'll meet again this evening at the party. Mr. Beaumont, we don't like each other very much, do we?
Not one bit.
Addington's gatherings at Morton were renowned for being noisy, excitable, busy affairs, plenty of guests and plenty of mingling. On that night, however, one of the residents of the house who remained absent was instead tucked away upstairs in her bed.
Come in, dear. You know, you ought to come in without knocking, child. It's not as if anybody else visits me.
Force of habit, I suppose, Granny.
Never mind that. How beautiful you look, dear Amelia. Give me a twirl. That's right. I tell you, you will have every man's eye on you downstairs.
I'm sure some of the ladies wouldn't stand for that.
You know, when I was your age, I used to have something very similar. Much longer, of course. But it was navy, too. And had such delicate white lace across the seams. My mother bought it for me as a gift for my birthday. I loved it so very dearly.
It sounds magnificent, Granny. I bet you looked lovely.
And I say, I danced away in it. The young chaps would be lining up for their turn. I used to love to dance, dear. It saddens me so very much that I can no longer. Well, I'll
make sure to dance for you. I promise.
Oh, now, don't cry, Amelia, my love. Your makeup will run. I've had my time for dancing.
Crying, Granny? I would never. Are you any closer to finishing that puzzle yet?
Only a few parts left. You see, the trouble with jigsaws is that the more you focus on the bits and pieces, the harder it is to see the whole picture.
I know, Granny. Well, you'll feel better once it's all done. I can stay and help you finish it. If you like.
Don't be silly, dear. You go downstairs and enjoy yourself. I have nowhere to go.
Well, if you're sure.
Yes, my dear. Kiss me before you leave. I'm very proud of you. Ah, there we are. The last piece. My jigsaw is finally complete, Amelia.
Oh, Granny,
I can't bear it. I wish there was something I could do.
Poor John Foss whiled away many an hour in the anteroom over that weekend, his uncooperative injured leg the only thing keeping him there. The excitement of his unexpected arrival had long worn off by the evening of Addington's party, and he found himself lost in thought as the house buzzed around him with last-minute preparations.
Hello, John. I hope I'm not disturbing you. I wanted to make sure that you weren't dying of boredom.
Eleanor, what a relief. I think you found me just in time.
It's beautiful, isn't it? I won't deny, I've been quite desperate for a chance to wear it.
Yes, it's quite beautiful.
I'm sure you'd brush up rather nicely too, given half a chance.
Yes, I'm bet-bound. You'll never know, will we?
Don't be so sure. Addington cannot bear to go a month without hosting one of his little gatherings, and I believe he's taken quite the shine to you. I'm sure you'll receive your very own invitation to one in the future.
Well then, our paths might cross again after all.
Indeed they might.
I'd like that.
I do believe they're about to start without me. I better save face and play my part.
How I wish I could come and dance with you.
On that ankle, John Foss. Why, I'd be picking you up from the floor all over again. I'll see you later.
If Foss could have miraculously sprang up from his pitiful place on the couch to offer his hand to Eleanor, even for just one short dance, he would have. But it was not to be. If only the ever so humble Miss Fenley Booth could be a fly on the wall to Foss and Carson's private conversations, she'd be well on her way to plead with her publisher. She'd title it something excruciating like Three Murders and Two Secret Lovers. Though Dorothy remained blissfully unaware of the growing affection between the injured man and the widow, she was still committed to drawing out mysteries and plotlines from the other guests, and there was no place more appropriate as a hunting ground than Addington's elegant party.
Well now, a young lady should never be stood on her own without a drink in hand and a gentleman to accompany her.
Oh, hello Dorothy. I'm just taking in Lord Addington's wonderful arrangement, is all.
It's quite a place to call home. A bit too far on the frivolous side for me.
I suppose. It is nice that Addington went to so much...
I suspect there are a few, some more than others, who would be willing to take your hand for a dance. And I'm sure your parents would encourage you to seize this opportunity of favour.
I'm not too sure I understand.
Oh, you're as naive as you look. You might be secure for now, thanks to your dear mother and father. But darling, you're a lady now. You've reached your prime and time goes by so quickly if you don't take hold of opportunities. The only reason why I'm the successful writer I am now is solely down to the fact that I never let time pass me by.
Well, yes. Thank you, Dorothy. I don't intend on wasting any time.
Now, I'm not suggesting you make yourself known to anyone other than those who are also looking for a fair companion like yourself. Maybe a certain county cricketer or a certain unmatched politician, perhaps.
Miss Booth, whilst I appreciate your suggestions, I feel my parents would prefer me to keep my options open. Mingle, you know? They want me to... Well, I won't say too much.
Oh, well, I won't impose more than one should. Although I can't help but note your smile has faded.
Well, this whole business circulates around Addington. My parents are keen for his favour. He's keen for their help funding this speculated production. I really should leave it at that.
A speculated production of what?
Excuse me, Dorothy. I think I'll go and get myself a drink after all. Enjoy the party.
The Lord... The business millionaires and the famous actress. That could make for a good story if I... Sir Andrew, good evening.
Ah, Dorothy. I was actually just about to make a comfort stroll.
Oh, I dare not stop you.
Yes, well...
Actually...
Well, yes?
I was just singing your praises to young Rose Rawlins.
I see.
You know, her parents are here in the hope of a graceful launch into society. With your decent political influence and the promising talk of your potential, it would be a smart match. A recalibration of allegiance. All very exciting.
Well, she's rather young and, well, it's a little more complex than that. Politics is not an exact science, as they say.
It seems simple to me. Politics may not be an exact science, but it's a game of survival of the fittest. Not unlike my best plot structures, in fact. if joining the Conservatives helps you sniff out your prey.
Dramatic as always, Dorothy.
But I'm not wrong. Maybe it's the Honourable Amelia you have in your sights.
Yes, well, that would require the interest of both parties, you know.
Two parties. You politicians and your clinical talk. Cease your false humility, Andrew. Miss Amelia should be delighted to have your interest. Her father certainly approves.
Everett?
Jeter? Mrs. Jeter? Sorry, what were you...
It's quite all right. I say that Mr. Jeter seems to be a dubious fellow. It's like he stares into your very soul. Do you two know each other?
Old friends.
Ah, but you're not too fond of him, I can tell. You see, I don't think many are.
Well, I wouldn't speak ill of them.
But you wouldn't speak well of them either.
Well, they're tolerable. I can't really tell you much else about them. I really must excuse myself, Miss Booth.
Of course.
By all accounts, the party was well underway, and Dorothy's storyboard was still falling short of ideas, despite her desperately invasive investigation into the lives of her peers. She really was barking up the wrong tree for gossip, however. If only she could have been privy to the exchange happening in the cool night air of the veranda.
I'm dreadfully sorry to disturb you, Miss Wilding. I just...
My goodness, man. You frightened me to death. Don't you know it's wrong to creep up on a lady in the dark?
My sincerest apologies, miss. I didn't mean to startle you. It's just, I've been asked to deliver you this letter.
From who, may I ask?
Well, the gentleman said to tell you. You'd know when you read it, miss.
Come now. Tom, isn't it? Why the secrecy?
My apologies, miss. I am only the messenger. I'm afraid I did not know the man.
Very well. Thank you, Tom. I know you want to see me, Zena. Stop lying to yourself and to me. If you don't come to meet me tonight, then I shan't go away. And I'll have to make my attempts more obvious, if that's the only way to gain your attention. Jack. Oh my goodness!
I say, Lawrence, did you see Zena go running past? She looked dreadfully upset.
I didn't, Dorothy, no. Too much champagne, I expect.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised. I feel quite giddy myself. That was splendid. I can barely keep up with you young souls. Don't let this girlish face fool you.
Don't flatter me. I'm really only useful on the pitch.
I think people are going for another dance. You should probably fetch Amelia for this. Where is she?
Not to worry. She's with Everett.
They look lovely.
Yes. He seems to be fond of her.
It appears you seem to be fond of her too.
I think she's delightful.
Both you and Everett. I'm sure you've heard the talk of Addington's desires to make them official.
Yes, I have heard talk of his political arrangements, but there's no confirmation as far as I'm concerned.
Yes, I imagine it wouldn't be your ideal.
You see through me, don't you, Miss Booth? My ideal would be to see Amelia happy with someone who is truly devoted to her in both friendship and partnership. Someone who would treat her with the dignity and gentleness she deserves.
You are very fond of her.
I just don't think politics and marriage should play in the same match. The two are completely separate entities. If the purpose is to be political, let it be political. But if the purpose is love, well, you understand what I'm saying, in short.
Yes, quite. Oh, I do apologise. My mind seems to wander off. The buzzing brain of a writer, you know.
Happens to the best of us.
I just can't seem to take my eye off of those Chaiters. I haven't met them yet.
Ah, don't let me impose. Please.
Have you had the pleasure?
Well, I've met them, if that's what you mean.
I really ought to go and introduce myself. Thank you for the dance, Lawrence. Hello.
No,
I don't mean to interrupt, but I thought I'd formally introduce myself. Dorothy Fenley Booth. A pleasure. The name may sound familiar to you.
Should it? It doesn't.
Oh. Well, I'm sure you've heard of my novels. The Red House, Midnight Marshes. You must have.
No, we haven't.
That's fine. Forgive me, I'm sure you would enjoy them. I'm just about to publish The Copper Urn. It's a really interesting little story.
Sorry,
about it.
Sorry, how can we help you? I don't mean to sound rude, but this music has given me a terrible headache.
Oh, well, I just thought it would be nice to come and say hello. I know so little about you. You're good friends with Sir Andrew, are you not?
Old friends.
I see. You must be close for him to invite you all the way to Morton Hall.
Evidently.
And may I ask what brought about your friendly friendship?
Business. We are associates, you could say.
Oh, this headache is increasing by the second.
Nothing a large glass of water and a...
Are we finished here, miss?
Booth. Of course.
You didn't mention you had a headache.
Of course I don't have a headache. I just don't care to stand around listening to inane drivel.
Well, quite.
What have I told you about engaging with these crafty people?
Oh, the conversation was harmless. Besides, she seems too dense to ever notice a thing.
She's a writer. It's her job to see details.
Yes, but undoubtedly a bad one. The Red House and Midnight Marshes.
Ah, there she is, the famous Miss Amelia. Daddy certainly has put on a show this evening, hasn't he?
Mrs. Chater, isn't it? We haven't had the pleasure.
Charmed. Dancing with Everett, I see. You've played that one well.
Sorry, I don't think I see your meaning.
Oh, come on now, girl, don't play it coy. Your father's most keen for a match. That much is clear.
It's certainly a smart one. You should seize the chance. Clever girls marry well.
Then I must be an extraordinarily stupid one.
I'd say you must be if you carry on splitting your attention for that cricket chap.
I beg your pardon. Lawrence and I are good friends.
Certainly doesn't seem that way to everyone else.
He's beneath you, Miss Addington. Not a sensible choice.
You go too far. How dare you?
Well, there's no need to be rude to your father's guests. Is there?
As I recall it, you're not guests of my father's. You're guests of Everett's. And if this is the company he keeps, then I should say I'm a very smart girl indeed. Good night.
And so closes part one of Mystery at Morton Hall. Join us tomorrow for the second and final instalment. Same place, same time. Thank you and good night.